Everybody in East Belfast knew what Jim Gray was up to.
And he said to me, "Now I know you have a bad heart. I want you to take another heart attack in front of me. I want you to die."
That night, he was telling two young kids that, you know, they would get the gold necklace if they came to my house and they shot me.
I told him that he would most definitely not live very long, which was the case, sadly, but truly.
Certain lifestyles attract certain types of enemies.
I'm glad Big Gray is gone, and maybe one day, when we're both down below, you know, we'll have a chance to sort out that unfinished business.
Exactly 1 month ago tonight, Jim Gray was shot dead here outside his father's home in East Belfast. I had spoken to Jim Gray 24 hours before, and he had given no indication that he feared for his life. But his killing surprised few, except maybe Gray himself. And it's now believed that he was murdered, like other UDA bosses before him, by his own. Time had run out for the man they called the Brigadier of Bling.
Paid the cost to be the boss.
Jim Gray had become a caricature of paramilitary criminality and excess, all over flash. From the tan to the clothes, from the jewellery to the cocaine. A mob boss, and in the best mob tradition, grooming his son, Jonathan, to follow suit. They would both die because of it. It might have been different. Look at me. Know what you see? James Smith Gray was born in East Belfast 47 years ago. He ran with the Young Newton Gang in the Lower Newtonards Road, but mostly played golf, off a 3 handicap, here at the Shandon Park Golf Club.
Jim Gray was like myself, working class, East Belfast. I lived in the Brignall Estate. Adjacent to that was the Clarewood Estate, that's where he grew up. Good family, father a gentleman.
By the time Gray got married in 1979, he was working in shorts, thanks to his wife, Anne Tedford. Anne, who has been dogged by illness since, remembers when he wanted to join the police. She has spoken to us, but didn't want her face shown on camera.
He was a gentleman. I suppose when you're that age, you just think you get married and live happily ever after. But you don't.
Was he a good husband?
At the beginning, yes.
Jim Gray could have meandered into obscurity or maybe golfing glory, but the lure of paramilitarism and the UDA would prove too strong. It was the largest paramilitary organisation, but riven by internal feuds. It was through these Gray was able to get close to the top of the organisation. New Year's Eve, 1982, and to Gray's delight, a son, baby Jonathan, is born. By coincidence, a leading UDA man's son was born the same day in the same ward. Jim offered him a lift home that night.
After Jonathan was born, Jim and the man that was visiting his wife, that Jim gave a lift home to, started like going places together, doing things together. The start of the friendship was when they met, when Jonathan was born.
Was that the beginning of a different Jim?
No, not really. Jonathan was about 2 when things started going wrong.
How did you know they're going wrong?
I just knew the way he was behaving, and just I knew that there was something going on, but I didn't know what it was.
Anne was divorced by the time Jim Gray's involvement in the UDA became clear. In 1990, he was arrested with his new associate, Gary Matthews, after a botched robbery at this garage in East Belfast. Remarkably, this incident was about the closest the police ever came to convicting Gray for serious crime. Gray and Matthews were accused of robbing the garage owner after months of blackmailing him. Both men were caught in the act and jailed pending trial, which led to Gray's first encounter with Johnny Adair. The now exiled Loyalist leader, who was himself deeply involved in drugs and terrorism, already had a notorious reputation by the time they met.
First time I met Jim Gray was in a criminal prison, where he was on remand for robbing a garage.
What was he like then?
Just as he was in recent times, just loud and boisterous and silly.
Did he have a reputation?
None whatsoever. He was unknown. I didn't know him then. Didn't know of him.
The case against Gray and his associate Gary Matthews eventually collapsed. Gray was free to carry on his rise up the UDA's ladder.
East Belfast, UDA, in particular, their leadership, were not playing an active role in the fight against violent Republicans. And when the old school, when East Belfast were stood down, it was an opportunity for Gray and his associate to move in and seize an opportunity to become who they eventually became.
But it was not a bloodless path to the top. When Ned McCreary, the East Belfast Brigadier, and with an infamous reputation himself, was shot dead, rumours linked Gray and another leading Loyalist, Geordie Legg, to the killing.
It isn't rocket science to work out that once Ned was removed, Gray and a close associate of his took over East Belfast. And that's internal, you know, and housekeeping, and I didn't agree with it. You know, I knew Ned McCreary.
The funeral passed by the Avenue 1 bar, McCreary's pub, en route to Roselawn Cemetery. Gray and his associate, Gary Matthews, would soon be running the pub and, in turn, the East Belfast UDA.
Once the old leadership was removed and it was replaced by Gray and his associate, the UDA leadership felt that these were a new breed that was going to deliver for the UDA in East Belfast.
By 1998, Jim Gray, here at the side of Michael Stone at a political rally, was known as the UDA's East Belfast Brigadier. But Spotlight has been told that he wasn't.
I don't believe he was a real brigadier. I believe there was another man. And I believe that Gray just put his face up front and attended meetings and gave the impression he was a brigadier. But to my knowledge and my understanding, he most definitely was not the brigadier of East Belfast.
It's all about self-promotion. And as I said, the close associate of his, who was the brigadier, who was my brigadier, and I like the man, and have respect for him even to this day. He just led Gray for years. You know, you want to jump in there and be seen as the public face. But I'm the one who makes the decisions. I'm the one who goes to the inner circle, takes the serious decisions regarding the membership of the East Belfast UDA.
Gray was the front man. The real leader is said to have been his associate, Gary Matthews, the man he first met in a maternity ward. Matthews is rarely seen on camera, but is pictured here at the funeral of murdered UDA leader John Gregg. Matthews was the real power, while Gray played the role of Big Boss. Many senior Loyalist figures from the east of the city were seen to be present when Stone was released for good in 2000. Not Matthews. If he was there, he kept his head down, unlike the official brigadier. That same day, Gray could be seen in all his glory, his son Jonathan beside him, faithfully mimicking his dad's get-up. Gray Sr. already had another look-alike, William James Murphy, his friend and bodyguard Murph. That they had shared passions was plain. Graves' lifestyle choices were expensive, the clothes, the jewellery and holiday tan. By now, he and Matthews controlled the Avenue 1 pub and the Bunch of Grapes bar. But Gray's wealth was based on drugs, which he also consumed in large quantities.
the money bag came out, white powder, started making lines on the table in front of me, and I'm sitting there sweating, thinking the police are going to raid the place, and it won't be Jim Gray caught with drugs, it's Michael Stone on coke, throw him back in jail.
The cocaine is said to have made Gray paranoid and also violent.
Think about Bayern Munich and Liverpool and Chelsea.
Eddie Harvey, secretary of the Westbourne Glentoran Supporters Club, experienced Gray's rage.
He wanted up the stairs. I said, you can't get up the stairs. So he hit me two digs in the face. And he said to me, now I know you have a bad heart. I want you to take another heart attack in front of me. I want you to die.
But Gray didn't just threaten violence. After he fell out with Geordie Legg, the man who helped clear the way to the top for him, Legg's mutilated body was found with multiple stab wounds.
I believe he was involved in Geordie being taken out. One, he was frightened of Geordie. Geordie had done a few favours for him that helped him get into the position he was. Geordie may have had aspirations himself, from what I hear, as in leadership role in East Belfast.
Whatever his involvement, Gray and his gang were never held to account for the killing by the UDA's inner council.
In particular, incidents like a Geordie Legg murder, they would not have explained in detail as to what, where and why it happened. They give their reasons and they didn't have to go into detail with the council, and I think that was wrong. I believe that the council should have had a full report and investigation into why such an active volunteer like Geordie Legg had been murdered in such a brutal way.
If Gray did have a hand in Geordie Legg's murder, he had no shame. Gray attended the funeral. He can be seen walking behind the hearse, paying his final respects. But the next funeral he would attend would be that of his own son. No one disputes that Jim Gray adored his son, Jonathan, the little boy who would once seem destined for another life.
He went to school, he got a grade A in his 11 plus, and he chose to go to Inst. He was very clever.
But over time, Jonathan appeared to lose interest in education. He had wanted to be a solicitor. That prospect was fading.
He was in school until I realised that he was taking drugs, and I asked his father would he take him and sort him out, but his father just pulled him deeper into it.
Jim Gray's lifestyle was irresistible to an impressionable teenager.
He always had money. He was 17 years of age and he drove a BMW. He just had everything he wanted, he got.
He was a mirror image, you know, the orange tan, the white slacks, and, you know, looked like something from an Italian playboy, you know. Nice young fellow. I came in and he says, can I try that? To his father, Gray, and he snorted some of his gear and says, oh, that's crap, and try mine. And JJ put it down and both snorted, and Gray agreed. He says, yeah, you better quality your stuff. Who's your supplier? And JJ laughed and says, you.
On the 12th of March 2002, Jonathan Gray died in Thailand while on holiday with his father and friends. A statement was released on behalf of Jim Gray saying that his son had died because of a fatal reaction to an inoculation.
And I just couldn't believe it. It was a nightmare.
His mother wasn't allowed any role at the funeral, but did get to choose one song and see her son one last time.
I just told him I loved him, and I fixed his hair. I kissed him, told him I loved him. Put a white rose in the coffin with him.
Jim Gray stayed outside during the short service. He appeared deeply affected by the death.
The service was about to begin, and I said, Jim, you better get on in there. And he said, Mervyn, I'm not going in. I said, why not, Jim? It's the funeral of your son. He said, I would only hear the gospel in there. He says, and I already know the truth. I don't want to hear it. And I found that very sad and very telling in many ways.
There was a revealing postscript. An autopsy report suggested the true account of Jonathan's death had been suppressed. In fact, he died after taking heroin. His father had been nearby and had been taking drugs himself. Whatever private turmoil Jim Gray might have had, his gang continued their ruthless violence. The police reconstructed one vicious killing which was attributed to them. However, Gray's drug taking was beginning to affect his credibility within the UDA. When Johnny Adair was released, Gray still appeared a leading figure in the organisation. But by the time the Brigadier of Bling went to meet the Secretary of State, John Reid, there was mounting anger at his lifestyle.
He came across embarrassingly for the Loyalist people, and in particular the people of East Belfast, which he supposedly represented. It. Everyone present came dressed in suits, and he came in jeans, boots, a pink shirt, BMW, tropical gold.
The root of Gray's problem was his cocaine addiction. He wasn't even trying to hide it at sessions of the Loyalist Commission.
I remember one particular meeting where Jim arrived and he appeared to have taken some substance. I have to say, I don't know whether it was drink or drugs, but it was certainly empowering his speech. People spoke to him after that, and he was asked not to come along the meetings again if he had was either high on drugs or drink.
Despite his erratic behaviour, Gray's luck held out when he was shot in the face in September 2002. He survived to walk in another funeral, that of John Gregg, shot dead in a UDA feud. However, the cocaine rages continued apace, and when these were reported in the Sunday World, Gray turned his attention to the paper's northern editor.
Easter 2003, a very senior policeman came to my door and said that Gray was standing in his bar and he had enough cocaine up his nose, enough snow up his nose, to cover the Alps in January, the Swiss Alps in January, and he said that he wanted me shot dead that night, and he was trying to get two boys to go and do it. And the policeman asked me to get out of the country for a couple of weeks to let things cool off, because things had been very, very hot, to let things cool off and to take my family with me.
Gray was out of control. Having sold his interest in his two pubs, he now appeared intent on taking over the Westbourne Glentoran Supporters Club.
I think he was trying to muscle in. Well, he had said to people, I'm going down and I'm going to take over the club. I'm going to take one of the rooms off him first, and then we'll go from there.
It is now clear that by this time the UDA had lost patience with the Brigadier of Bling.
I don't think he was taken for the UDA. I think he was taken for his own empire. I can say that honestly.
By this point, the UDA leadership was also trying to distance itself from drugs. The message was pointedly clear.
There's no such thing as a loyalist drug dealer. You're a loyalist or you're a drug dealer. A loyalist wouldn't be a drug dealer, and a drug dealer wouldn't allow to be a loyalist.
Finally, last March, Gray was instructed to attend a meeting of the UDA's inner council. Not only was he throwing his weight about too much, but he'd also issued death threats against two leading loyalists. He was to be charged with treason. But Gray and his associate Gary Matthews didn't attend. Instead, Gray organised a gathering of his own.
He called a meeting in the Bunch of Grapes for his supporters to turn up in their thousands. He walked into an empty bar. Five or six of his cronies, you know, that he supported financially were there.
Spotlight understands that Gary Matthews then told him it was all over.
The man who had him join the UDA came in and actually said, this is all the support you can muster to hold on to East Belfast. The game's up. Jack it in.
The inner council had finally moved against Gray, standing down all his gang, including Matthews. But the UDA had chosen its time carefully, only moving after Gray had lost support.
He had become a liability in what he was involved in and in his image to the organisation. His actions were tended to become more outrageous, if you believe the stories that were floating about at the time, how he treated people. And I believe the UDA are in the process of moving beyond the conflict, in the process of transformation. And Jim Gray didn't fit into that, nor appear that he would have fitted into that.
Days after being stood down, Gray was arrested on the Belfast-Dublin road. He had £3,000 cash and a banker's draft for £10,000 in his possession. It's understood that Gray and his girlfriend, who was arrested with him, were planning to go to Spain for a few days. Not for good, at least not on this trip. Gray was subsequently charged with money laundering. Two others, including leading estate agent Philip Johnson, faced related charges, which they deny. Gray was held at McGarbury Prison on remand and then began receiving letters from an unlikely source.
Well, I was slagging him off, telling him how he was embarrassing to East Belfast and the loyalist people of Ulster.
And did you invite him to reply? Or was that that he...
Well, he replied himself. He sent me a letter.
This is the letter that Gray wrote to his former enemy, who, like him, was also expelled from the UDA. Littered with spelling mistakes, it suggests Gray was barely literate, but also that he was very alone.
I believe he's trying to offer his hand of friendship to mine. I believe that he realised that the world was against him and he'd nowhere to hide. And I believe that he was offering his hand of friendship to mine.
In the letter, Gray said that he intended to stay at his father's home in East Belfast if he got out on bail. Adair wrote back.
I strongly advised him not to do that, because if he was doing that, I told him that he would be most definitely not live very long, which was the case, sadly, but truly. My advice to him was, if and when you get out of prison, just pack up and leave, because you haven't a friend in the world. And it was evident once he was charged and remanded in custody that all his so-called friends and comrades who a year ago was singing his praises, but now once the chips were down, the knives were out and they were stuck into his back and twisted.
In September, Jim Gray was released on bail. The police had opposed the application, citing death threats, but the judge said the courts couldn't take decisions based on what the paramilitaries might or might not do.
I think we also have to appreciate that Mr. Gray himself applied for bail, knowing that his life may be in danger. So he wanted to be released back into the public, and he was obviously responsible as well for his own safety and for his own measures to protect himself too.
1 month ago tonight, Jim Gray walked out of his father's house and was shot dead. It was a clinical killing.
And on this particular night, somewhere around 8 p.m, it seems that there was a prayer arrangement to meet with a friend and associate of his. It seems that Jim Gray had wanted to have some of his weights back. He was keen on training. His associate and Jim Gray were standing at the back of his friend's car. They were doing the exchange, the boot was opened, a car approached. It seems that one person got out of this car and walked towards Jim Gray. The gunman then pointed the gun at Jim Gray and opened fire. It seems there were approximately 3 shots, two of which hit Jim Gray. Jim Gray died pretty quickly at the scene.
The friend who had delivered the weights was Gary Matthews, his former business partner and the one-time real brigadier of East Belfast's UDA. He was arrested at the scene and questioned. 5 other people were also detained. All were released. Spotlight now understands that members of East Belfast UDA murdered Jim Gray. He knew too much and may have been about to set up his own criminal empire.
I believe he had the criminal contacts there for his drugs, for his extortion. And I believe he would have tried to set something up there, recruit, you know, either within the ranks or ex-members of different loyalist paramilitary organisations. I believe he would have tried to start another fiefdom.
Within days of Gray's killing, a celebratory bonfire was being prepared in nearby Dundonald. Most telling of all was the tiny funeral cortege. Gray, a connoisseur of funerals, would have understood. it is almost impossible to find anyone with a good word to say about Jim Gray.
It's life, you know, somebody's lost their life, you know what I mean? And one way it was a relief to me, and another way it wasn't a relief, was I hate to see anybody getting down. Say I lost my grandson, and with a brain tumour, and it hurt me. But when I seen like a Jim Gray running about, and me losing my grandson, the world didn't seem right.
Pen pal Johnny Adair says Gray's death didn't bother him.
To be honest, I lost no sleep over it because he done me no favours. He was part and parcel of what happened to my family and my friends.
There was a time when Jim Gray was stuck to Michael Stone's shoulder, but Gray ended up threatening Stone's life. The former neighbours never resolved a dispute that went back to teenage years.
He had the God complex, so to speak. You know, I can order young men who don't want to take life, you know, who don't want to go and beat people up. I can do that, you know. So he developed that complex, and he developed a complex where he thought he was bigger than loyalism. He thought he was bigger than the UDA. And no one man, as Johnny Adair found out, is bigger than the UDA. I'm glad Big Grey is gone. And maybe one day, when we're both down below, you know, we'll have a chance to sort out that unfinished business.
Meanwhile, Anne Tedford faces the prospect of mourning her son at the grave of the man she blames for his death.
Well, I don't want his name to go on Jonathan's headstone. If that name's not there, then I feel that I can go see my son, talk to my son, and if his name was added to the headstone, then I don't think I could go.
The Love Ulster rally on the Shankill Road last weekend aimed at forging a new unionist unity. Loyalism, too, is keen to present a new face to the world.
There can be no more Jim Grays. No more Jim Grays in loyalism. Loyalism has to move on. Loyalist paramilitaries have to move on. They have to have a say in the future of this country. And they know themselves the only way they're going to do this is by leaving certain baggage behind.
Jim Gray, the Brigadier of Bling, left a legacy of death, fear, drugs and criminality. Questions remain, like how were he and his gang able to operate so freely for so long? And will his death really bring an end to criminality in the ranks of the UDA? Time will tell.